ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। सो वेलकम एवरीबॉडी, टुडे वी विल कंटिन्यू विद द बौद्ध फिलॉसफी, the philosophy of the followers of Lord Buddha, Gautama Buddha. Two things are left for discussion, two topics. One is the philosophical implications of Buddha's teachings, and the other is schools of Buddhism. So today we will discuss the philosophical implications of Lord Buddha's teachings, and the next week most probably we will discuss the different schools of Buddhism. Just one or two schools we will discuss, the important ones. So let's start with the philosophical implications of Lord Buddha's teachings. Now, some of these philosophical implications have been explicitly stated by Buddha himself. So we will just mention four of these views on which the ethics taught by Buddha depends, and these four are connected. So the first one is the most important, and the other three follows from the first one. The first one we have discussed a little in brief, but we'll have to go into more detail if we want to understand the philosophical implications as well as the schools of Buddhism. The first one is the most important. So I will first mention the four of them, then we will discuss them one by one. So first is the theory of dependent origination. We have already discussed it. It is this theory of Pratitya Samutpada, the theory of dependent origination. The second, which follows from this, is the theory of karma. It is absolutely identical with what the Vedanta teaches, the theory of karma. The third is the theory of change. And the fourth is the theory of the non-existence of the soul. Non-existence, mind you. This is a little different from what Vedanta teaches. So one by one we will discuss these in a very short way, just to have a little idea. So the first of these, Pratitya Samutpada, or the theory of dependent origination, or the conditional existence of things, is the most important, and the other three follow from this. So let us try to understand this, because Lord Buddha himself has laid great emphasis on this theory. He is even supposed to have said that this theory, the theory of dependent origination, is Dhamma. In Pali, you know, they say Dhamma. In Sanskrit, they say Dharma. So Lord Buddha himself is supposed to have said that this is Dhamma. What? The theory of dependent origination. See, this name itself gives us some idea. Dependent origination. Each substance in the world, everything in the world, has an origin. So dependent origination means each substance origin is dependent on something. Nothing in the world is uncaused or independent. The origin or birth of everything in the universe is dependent on something. So this is also called the conditional existence of things. Conditional existence means something can only exist if there are some conditions which are satisfied. Nothing can be completely independent of everything in the universe. This, in short, is the theory. So, according to this theory, there is a spontaneous and universal law of causation. Law of causation, we all know that one thing causes another thing and itself is the cause of something else. Suppose A, B, C. Now B, if we take, B will be the cause of A and C will be the cause of B. B will be related to both A and C. How? B will be the cause of A and C in turn will be the cause of B. So this is, in simple words, this is the theory of causation. So the universal law of causation conditions the appearance of all events, mental and physical. Condition means it limits. You see, B is caused by A. So something which is not in A cannot be in B. So that is how B is conditioned by A. In turn, C is also conditioned by B. So all events, mental as well as physical, are conditioned by something. Each thought, what we think, suppose we just close our eyes and just watch our thoughts, then we will see, if 5 or 6 minutes we see, we will see how one thought leads to another thought, that thought leads to another thought. So each thought is caused by another thought. And that thought also is caused by a third thought. So physical, of course, we know in physical world, every day we see that each thing is the cause of something else. Like our clothes, etc. These are woven from threads. So threads are the cause of our clothes. And all the things we see in the world, we just analyze, they have to be caused by something. And they in turn will be the cause of something else. So this is called the law of causation, according to which everything, all events, mental as well as physical in this world, is tied down, is governed by this law. And this law in Buddhism is called the law of Dhamma or Dharma. Now please don't confuse the meaning of Dharma of Buddhism with the Dharma of Hinduism. They are completely different. So Dhamma or Dharma of Buddhism means this law of dependent origination, also called Pratitya Samutpada. So this law in Buddhism works automatically. Nobody is there to govern this. In the nature of things, it is such that this law works automatically without the help of any conscious guide. This is different from the Vedanta principle. Vedanta believes that Ishvara or God controls this law. But in Buddhism, this law works automatically. So in accordance with this law, whenever a particular event appears, it is followed by another event, which is its effect. So on getting the cause, the effect arises. This is the simple thing. Cause being there, the effect will come automatically. And the existence of everything without exception is conditional. Conditional means dependent on a cause. Nothing happens fortuitously or by chance. This is called the theory of dependent origination. So this view Buddha himself makes clear avoids two extremes. What are those two extremes? One will be eternalism. Eternalism means some reality eternally exists independent of any condition. This is one extreme, that something is there which is completely uncaused, which is independent of everything. This is one extreme. And the other extreme is nihilism, that something which exists can cease to be completely. See, try to understand this. On one side will be the principle, on one extreme, that there is something which is completely uncaused. It is not dependent on anything. And the other side, the other extreme will be that the existence of something can be totally annihilated. So Buddha stands in the middle. He says that nothing can be uncaused, nothing can be independent of everything on one side. Secondly, nothing can disappear completely from the face of the earth without leaving an effect. Disappearance is nothing but being converted into something else. So these two extremes, Buddha denies that something can be completely wiped out, or that something can be completely independent and will never be affected by anything. So Buddha avoids those two extremes and says that no, there is nothing which is completely independent, and there is also nothing which will be completely wiped out from the face of the earth without leaving any effect. So according to this, each substance in the world is connected with everything else. Cause and effect, it is like a chain, one by one by one by one by one, leading to infinity. There is no end, because the universe will continue through all eternity. So this is how both the extremes are avoided. And the middle view is taken by Buddha, that everything we perceive possesses an existence but is dependent on something else. And that thing in turn does not perish without leaving some effect. This is the thing. So just to give you an idea, comparison idea, Vedanta believes that the cause is nothing but the effect. The effect is not different from its cause. One point. Second point, Vedanta believes that there is one substance. You cannot call it substance. You can call it reality. There is one reality which is beyond this world, which is completely independent. It cannot be affected by anything. As Sri Krishna says in the Gita to Arjuna, fire cannot burn it, air cannot dry it, water cannot wet it. This is just a beautiful way of expressing that supreme reality is independent of everything. So these I just wanted to mention, so you can link those two. Now, Buddha attaches so much importance to the understanding of this theory of Pratitya Samutpada, that he calls this theory Dhamma. He is quoted as saying, let us put aside questions of the beginning and the end. I will teach you the Dhamma. What is the Dhamma according to Buddha? That being thus, this comes to existence. And from the coming to be of that, this arises. That being absent, this does not happen. From the cessation of that, this ceases. This is how Buddha is quoted. It is very simple. It seems complex, but it is very simple. That being, this arises. So since clothes, suppose we take the example of clothes. So these have been woven. Now, if the raw material was not there, the clothes would not have come into existence. So that being, this arises. And when that ceases to be, this also does not happen. So suppose I bang my fingers like this on the table. Okay. Now if I bang it hard, I feel a reaction. I get hurt by the table. So that being, this arises. Means if I do this action, there is a reaction. But if there is no action, there will be no reaction. This is the simplest way of putting this theory. So, but it has far implications, which you will see. So, Buddha says that understanding this theory means understanding Dhamma. So, this theory, according to Buddha, is compared to a staircase, a long staircase, by mounting which one can look around on the world and see it with the eye of the Buddha. So this means that one who mounts this staircase reaches a very elevated level. He transcends the common understanding and looks upon the world with the eye of Buddha, means with the eye of enlightenment. This is the importance which Buddha gives to this theory. Means according to him, those who understand it perfectly will get enlightenment. This is the theory of Dhamma. So we have already seen how this theory is applied to the solution of the question regarding the origin of misery, origin of suffering. Last class we had discussed the 12 links which cause suffering. So among those links, the first one you will remember is ignorance. Ignorance of what? Ignorance of the fourfold truth. And one by one there are links. So finally, this leads to suffering. This law is applied there also, because according to this law, nothing is uncaused. So our suffering also must have a cause. This law says that if that is not there, this will also not be there. So if the cause is not there, the effect will also not be there. So Buddha says what to do, how to remove suffering. You remove the cause of suffering. If the cause will be there, effect has to be there. So if we don't remove the cause, we cannot get rid of suffering. So the best way of removing something is remove its cause altogether. So we have seen this. So there also this law of Pratitya Samutpada has been applied. Now, we will also see how profound this law is and what are some of its other implications. So the second one is the first law. Now what follows from this law is the theory of karma. The theory of karma in Buddhism is absolutely identical to that of Hinduism. So the belief in the theory of karma is only an aspect of this doctrine. What does this theory say? This theory says that the present existence of an individual is according to the karma he has performed previously. So our present condition is the effect of our past karma, and our future will be the effect of our present karma. Okay, this has been seen very clearly already in connection with the explanation of the origin of suffering. So the law of karma is only a special form of the general law of causation as conceived by Buddha. So law of karma, we already have an idea, so I won't go into detail, we have already discussed it. So first is the theory of dependent origination. Second, what follows from this is the law of karma. The third thing which follows from this is the doctrine of universal change or impermanence. This is also very important, and in some ways it matches the principles of Vedanta, because Vedanta also says that everything is anitya. Anitya means ephemeral. Nothing in the universe will remain forever. Everything comes and goes. So this is the doctrine of universal change. Okay. So the doctrine of dependent origination also yields the Buddhist theory of the transitory nature of things. All things Buddha repeatedly teaches, like the saints of all religions. Buddha also teaches that all things are subject to change and decay. As everything originates from some condition, it disappears when the condition ceases to be. So whatever has a beginning also has an end. Buddha therefore says that, I'm quoting Lord Buddha, know that whatever exists arises from causes and conditions and is in every respect impermanent. That which seems everlasting will perish. That which is high will be laid low. Where meeting is, parting will be. Where birth is, death will come. This is what Buddha says. That which seems everlasting. We all think we will live forever. We may say that no, we know that we will die, but actually we don't know. We don't realize that fact. If we realized it, our lives would change completely. So in our subconscious mind, we think that this world is permanent. Everything will be the same. But no, Buddha says that which seems everlasting will perish. That which is high will be laid low. So many persons in the years gone by, they were once very famous. They were talked about, discussed about. Now people have forgotten them. Nobody even remembers them. So that which is high will become low. Then again, that which is low will become high. Where meeting is, parting will be. When we meet somebody, we cannot remain with him forever. It is impossible. the parting has to be there, because anything which comes has to go, and where birth is, death will come. It has to come. You cannot prevent it. Rabindranath says, Jonmile murte hobe, omor ke kotha kobe. If you are born, you have to die. Kothay, where and in what time have you seen anybody live forever? It cannot be. So this is the same thing which Buddha says. So transitoriness of life and worldly things is spoken of by so many poets and so many philosophers. But what Buddha did was, Buddha logically perfected this view into the doctrine of impermanence. And later Buddhists, means the followers of Buddha, they developed this theory further into the theory of momentariness. Kshanikavada. Kshanika means momentary. So everything, according to these later Buddhists, exists for one partless moment, kshanika. You know, I was surprised to read the definition of a point. So what is a point? A point is something which has no length, breadth or height. It is nothing. But it is, we are asked to believe in that. So this is the same as the moment of the Buddhists. Moment means it has no existence in the time length, but still it exists. So each substance, according to this theory of momentariness, exists for only one partless moment. So that moment actually does not exist in time, just like a point. But the surprising thing is, we still see substances originating, staying and perishing. So actually what we see, according to Buddhists, what we see is just a series of changes. Actually, we don't see any substance at all. Because the substance does not exist for more than a moment. And that moment actually, that is a partless moment. So this is something we cannot really grasp with our intellect. It is in a different realm. So this is the theory of momentariness, according to which all things last not even for a short period of time, but exist for one partless moment only. This is the theory of change or impermanence. Now we come to the fourth and last one, which is the theory of non-existence of the soul. Okay. So the law of change is universal. Neither man nor any other being, animate or inanimate, is exempt from this law. Now it is commonly believed that in a human being, there is an abiding substance called the soul. Sanskrit, it is called Atma. So, there is a belief that we have an Atma, a Jeevatma, which persists through changes that overcome the body. And this Jeevatma, Vedanta believes that exists before the birth of this body, and also after the death of this body, and migrates from one body to another. Like Vedanta believes that we have existed in other bodies, my soul, has existed in other bodies before this body was born, and after this body dies, it will transfer itself to another body. This will continue till I am liberated. Then the soul merges with the Supreme Soul. This is what Vedanta believes. But Buddhism denies this. Buddhism denies this, that one, there is a soul which migrates from one body to another. But then it may be asked, then how does he explain the continuity of a person through different births, or even through different states of childhood, youth and old age? See, I am a youth, suppose I am a middle-aged person. Now I remember when I was young, then it is the same I which will become old. So if you don't believe in the soul, what connects this youth, childhood and old age? Answer, Buddha says that we don't deny the continuity of the stream of successive states that compose this life. So Buddhism says there is no soul. What is there? Continuous. There is a stream of continuous states. It seems difficult, but some examples will make it clear. What is this continuity of the stream of successive states? Let us try to understand this. According to Buddha, life is an unbroken series of states, one state after another. Now, each of these states depends on the conditions just preceding it and gives rise to the condition just succeeding it. Okay. So the continuity of this life series is therefore based on a causal connection running through the different states. So Buddha says, what is it which connects our childhood with our youth and our youth with our old age? He says, it is a causal connection. My middle age is dependent upon my youth, which was dependent upon my childhood. And then again, my old age will be dependent upon my middle age. So this, to explain this continuity, a very beautiful example is given. Suppose there is a lamp. Lamp means not an electric lamp. In those days, they had a flame. Suppose a candle. Now, a candle is burning throughout the night. Is the flame we see one moment, is it the same as the flame we see next moment? No. The flame of each moment is different. The flame continuously changes. And the flame of each moment is dependent on its own conditions and different from that of another moment, which is dependent on another condition. So, 1 second you see one flame, then you see another flame, then you see a third flame. So, the flame in between is dependent on the flame which preceded it. And the flame which come after depends on the flame which also preceded it. So, each flame, each moment is the effect of the flame which had come before it and is the cause of the flame which will come after it. So this is the causation, this is the unbroken succession of flames which is connected to one another by this law of causation. So again, as from one flame another may be lighted, and though the two are different, they are connected causally. Similarly, The end state of this life may cause the beginning of next life. Okay. Now see, when we light a flame with another one, does something go from the first flame to the next flame? No. The flame is just connected to this by causation. The flame lights up this flame. So Buddha says similarly, when we die, there is no soul which goes into another body. But just like the two flames, there is a successive chain bound by the law of causation. So rebirth is not transmigration. That is, it is not the migration of the same soul into another body. It is the causation of the next life by the present life. Okay, the conception of a soul is thus replaced by that of an unbroken stream of consciousness. As the present state of consciousness inherits its characters from the previous one, the past in a way continues in the present through its effect. The past continues in the present through its effect. So memory also thus becomes explainable without a soul. In this way. So, this theory of the non-existence of the soul, that is, anattavada, plays a very important part in understanding the teachings of the Buddha. So, Buddha therefore repeatedly exhorts his disciples to give up the false view about the self. He points out that people who suffer from the illusion of the self do not know its nature clearly. So he says that those who insist on saying that there is a soul, they are like persons who build a staircase for mounting a palace which they have never seen. Suppose a building is there, we have never seen a building, but we are building stairs to mount that. So Buddha says that those who believe in a soul are like that. They have never seen a soul, but they still believe in that. This is the thing. So according to Buddha, man is only a conventional name for a collection of different constituents. What are these constituents? First is this material body. Second is the mind or the immaterial body. And third is the formless consciousness, which is vijnana. So suppose we take an example of a chariot. A chariot is a collection of so many things. Wheels, axles, shafts. Okay. Similarly, Buddha says that a human being is only a collection of different constituents. The body, stool, this gross body, the subtle body, and consciousness. So the existence of man depends on this collection, and it dissolves when the collection breaks up. The soul or the ego denotes nothing more than this collection. And from a psychological point of view, man as perceived from without in within is also analyzable into a collection. This collection is of five things. What? One, form, that is called rupa, feelings of pleasure and pain, Vedana. Third, perception including understanding and naming, Sangya. Four, predispositions or tendencies generated by the impressions of past lives. And five, consciousness itself, which is Vijnana. So these four points are the philosophical implications of Lord Buddha's teachings. The first is the theory of dependent origination. On this one theory, we can say that the whole structure of Buddhism is based, and everything else follows from this one by one by one by one. The whole link of suffering, from ignorance to final suffering, is dependent on this very theory. So we can understand how important this theory of pratitya samutpada, or dependent origination, what an important role it plays in Buddhism. So I think we have had more than enough for philosophy for one day. So Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Tat Sat. Thank you. Dipali Di.
Pranam Maharaj, one question. Is the law of causation the same as law of existence?
Well, law of existence depends on how you define it. If you define it in this, law of existence is a general term. Now, everyone will define the law of existence in their own way, you see. So if you tell the Buddhists, then they will say that yes, law of existence is the law of causation. But somebody who defines it in another way may not say so. So it depends upon
the I am, therefore I exist, or I exist, therefore I am.
I am, therefore I exist. I don't see any causation here.
Or I exist, therefore I am.
Yeah, that this was said by a very famous philosopher, I think. I have forgotten the name, I don't recall. But I don't know whether this law is the law of causation or not. I don't think so. So I exist, therefore I am, does not say that I am the effect of something else and I will be effect of some other effect. So I don't know whether this can be termed as the law of causation.
Okay, thank you, Maharaj.
Okay.
In the first lecture that you said, the causation, and one of the things you did, the Lord Buddha says, is that the issue is of your Trishna.
Yeah.
The craving from your past existences,
yeah,
gives of the pleasurable things that you have experienced,
yeah,
gives you the reason to take the next birth to experience those pleasures again.
Yeah.
So my question is that when you are experiencing pleasurable things, you are also experiencing negative abhritrishna.
Yeah.
Negative things as well.
Yeah.
Why are those experiences not transferred from your previous experience to your new experiences?
Of course, those are transferred.
But then, if that is transferred, then why are they not cutting each other out? Like the pleasurable things, the moment you think of pleasurable things, then you say, you know what? Those pleasurable things also called being miseries.
Yeah, if that is our aim, because people don't have discrimination.
Based on the causation, that should happen.
That does not happen because our thirst for pleasures is so great that we ignore all the pains which we have suffered. That is why the scriptures again and again remind us that you cannot have pleasure without pain. And we have also experienced this in our previous births. All these experiences are carried on the future births. But our intellect is so dull, our attachment is so great, that we don't realize this simple fact when we realize it completely, that pleasure cannot be had without pain, we will grasp Buddha's truth that everything is suffering here, and we will give up both. Purvi Di and Anadi Babu.
Oh, very, very wonderful talk. Something very deep and something very enjoyable. Both. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Well, I have some questions, Maharaj.
Yeah.
You know, when you mentioned the law of causation, you know, how D, A, B, C, D, you gave example.
Yeah.
D is caused by C, C is caused by B, is caused by A. Then I thought, if B is caused by A, then how did A appear? Is A the original cause? Is there anything like original cause?
No, there cannot be origin. They cannot be, as we said just now. There cannot be origin because it will always have something before it. It is an infinite chain.
It's like a circle, sort of infinite. So it goes, goes ever, forever, ever and ever. Okay, that I understand.
Problem is, Purvidi, if you admit that it began with something, then what did that thing, where is the cause of that thing then? If I say that A was caused by zero, suppose, then Buddha will say, what is the cause of that zero? It cannot be uncaused. There has to be something before that.
Yeah.
Then it will be infinite. No, yeah. Because how can you find the beginning? There cannot be any beginning according to this law.
Right. Now I understand the infinity. It goes on and on.
Yeah.
And I have trouble with the theory of non-existence of soul.
Yeah.
So when a person dies, I have trouble. So what will happen? Rupa, feelings, all those things, perfection, memory, all those things, consciousness.
Yeah.
Transferred to the next birth.
We should not have any problem because we don't believe in Buddha's theory of the non-existence of the soul. We are Vedantins.
That's fine then.
We believe in the Jivatman.
That's fine then.
We will be going to another body. Don't worry at all.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Okay. So, okay then, most probably see you next week if everything goes well. And
Maharaj, one quick question.
Please.
Oh, actually, before the question, the class was amazing and I loved the whole discussion and how the interaction was. I think the discussion is also amazing. Is there like a recording of the class that I could, you know, listen to, because the discussion sounds like the class was amazing that I missed today, like parts of it.
Yeah, I upload the class every time on YouTube, but of course the discussion part I only take some selected portion. I don't upload the whole of it. So are you receiving our emails about the class?
No, Maharaj, this is my second class. I think I have to subscribe to the email list.
Yeah, please, there in our website, you will find a facility for subscription. So if you just give your email, I will enter that. And from then on, you will receive notifications of the classes also. And after I upload it on YouTube, I also send the links.
Okay, Raj, yeah.
And our YouTube link is also, generally I also give behind the beneath the notification. So once you have the YouTube link, that's all. We can find all the classes which are uploaded, you can find from that link.
Okay. Is it open? I email vancouver@rmrr.org. That's the email.
vancouver@rkmm.
Yeah, that one. Yes.
Okay. Yeah, you can email us also directly also, and you can subscribe also. There will be no chance of missing you then.
She's too far off.
Huh? Sorry. What? Balidi, you said something?
No, Maharaj, I was just telling.
Okay.
That's nothing. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much, Maharaj.
Thank you so much. So, time to bid goodbye for this week. Yeah. See you all next time. And that will be the final class. We will discuss a little on the various schools of Buddhism, especially Shunyavada, or what is called nihilism. That is a very interesting concept. So we will just have a small discussion on that. Okay. Keep well. Thank you. And see you soon. Okay.